model is proposed for allocation to the remaining ministries and departments. Among these, the largest share of the balance is proposed for the Ministry of Agriculture at 1.09 billion to cater for service charges, purchase of materials, foot and mouth disease outbreak, God forbid, and animal identification devices. The second largest share of the balance amounting to 908 million pula is recommended for the Minister of Trade and Industry to cover subventions to East Parastatals, especially the Silibe-Pikwe Economic Diversification Unit and its transformation into a company limited by guarantee. Statutory expenditure. Madam Speaker, the proposed statutory expenditure for 2016-17 financial year amounts to 6.91 billion, a decrease of 12.9% compared to 7.93 billion of the current financial year. The reduction in this provision is due to the 1.64 billion payment of government bond BW003 in 2015-16 financial year. Madam Speaker, I now turn to the important allocations under the development budget. Madam Speaker, a total development budget of 14.82 billion is proposed for the financial year 2016-2017. The Ministry of Defence, Justice and Security, with a proposed allocation of 3.59 billion, takes the largest share of the proposed budget, mainly to cater for provision of defense equipment, communications equipment, and infrastructure in order to improve BDF's defense capabilities. In addition, the allocation caters for construction of police stations as well as staff houses in the different locations in order to improve safety and security. The second largest share of 3.43 billion or 23.1% of the total is proposed for the Minister of Minerals, Energy and Water Resources. The budget caters for energy and water infrastructure in order to address the current supply shortages referred to earlier in my speech. The major energy infrastructure projects include Murupule A Power Station rehabilitation at 135 million, the Northwest Electricity Transmission Grid at 225 million, and the Rakola Substation at 257 million. Yeah, these things are continuing. Implementation is continuing. In addition, the Botswana Power Corporation requires cash injection of 1.35 billion to cater for emergency power supply, and 257 million pula under ESP for rural electrification. The water infrastructure projects include North-South Carrier 2 from Palape to Mamashia, Mahalape and the Palape network extensions, connection of Kanye and Molepolole to the North-South Carrier, Maung water supply and sanitation, and Kanye's sanitation, countrywide groundwater investigation, as well as various water supply interconnections. The Ministry of Transport and Communications, with a proposed budget of 1.41 billion, takes the third largest share to cater for construction of secondary roads, bridges, and trunk roads. The major projects under the Ministry of Transport, that is, Kazungula and Mohembo bridges, outbid performance road contract for Mankholi Dwaneng and Rakuna Mabule roads, as well as the traffic signals improvements and centralized traffic control in Haboroni, an initiative which is aimed at improving the flow of traffic in this our capital city. The proposed budget includes an estimated amount of 250 million for road projects under the ESP program. The fourth largest share is proposed for the Minister of Local Government and Rural Development at 1.22 billion. The budget mainly caters for Ipelegeng and destitute housing programs. Part of the ministry's budget for ESP projects at 315 million is for backlog eradication of primary school facilities, village infrastructure, and construction of customary courts. The Minister of Education and Skills Development, with a proposed budget of 1.09 billion, gets the fifth largest share, out of which a sum of 440 million pula is for the construction of teachers' houses, classrooms, and laboratories under ESP. If you didn't know the projects which fall under ESP, I think we are beginning to know what they are. Madam Speaker, the other ministries and departments share the remaining balance of the proposed development budget of 4.17 billion. The largest share of the balance is proposed for the Ministry of Lands and Housing at 910 million pula. The budget for Ministry of Housing mainly caters for land servicing at 338 million, land administration and processes, capacity and system, LAPCAS for short, at 354 million. The proposed budget also includes an amount of 272.9 million under ESP. aimed at accelerating the ongoing programs. The second largest share of the balance at 813 million pula is proposed for the Minister of Agriculture, of which 35 million is for ESP to cater for grey water reuse, Lotsani irrigation project, Glen Valley infrastructure rehabilitation, agricultural service centers needed by most farmers here in this house, and grading of roads servicing production areas, something long required by farmers in this country. The third largest share of the balance, amounting to 741 million, is proposed for the Minister of Health to cater for upgrading of health facilities and construction of staff houses throughout the country. And finally, a total of 600 million is proposed for the Ministry of State President. This caters for additional poverty eradication packages. Poverty eradication. Overall balance of this budget, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, with estimated total revenues and grants of 48.4 billion pula for 2016-17 financial year and proposed total expenditure net lending of 54.44 billion pula, the net result is an estimated budget deficit of 6.05 billion pula or 3.8% of GDP. In line with the principles of our medium-term debt management strategy, this budget deficit will be financed through a combination of drawing down on government savings. I don't want to say reserves, because when I say reserves, then people think of the 84.9 billion. So I'm making a distinction to say government savings, referring to the only 35 billion. Draw down from government savings, domestic borrowing and foreign borrowing, subject to analysis of the opportunity cost of each of these financing instruments. There is opportunity cost. And within the provisions of the relevant legislation, such as the Public Finance Management Act of 2011 and the Stocks, Bonds and Treasury Bills Act of 2005, all passed by this Parliament. In any event, Madam Speaker, this deficit of 6 billion and any other future budget deficit will be restricted to a ratio of up to 4% of GDP to avoid the country sliding into an unsustainable fiscal path. This is fiscal management. Fiscal management. A word, Madam Speaker, in passing, for the record on public service salaries. The record. Madam Speaker, negotiations on public service salaries are the prerogative of the Bargaining Council, which comprises the government and trade unions. It is important, however, to consider the prevailing global and domestic economic outlook, in particular the constrained fiscal space for 2016-17, arising from the depressed global demand for and prices of diamonds. We all need, Madam Speaker, to take into account these unfavorable economic fundamentals to ensure the country's future fiscal sustainability. We all need to do that. Madam Speaker, I move towards conclusion. Madam Speaker, as I conclude, I wish to point out that the medium-term fiscal outlook is a cause for concern. It's a cause for concern, given the modest growth prospects for the domestic economy. I therefore call upon all ministries to exercise restraint in requesting for additional funding through supplementary budgets during the course of the financial year, as this would simply worsen the fiscal situation. I must also hasten to add that the development of this country is a matter of mutual social responsibility and not that of the government alone. While the government has shown and continues to show visionary leadership by adopting policies and programs aimed at inclusive growth, it is the responsibility of both the public service and the private sector to deliver on these programs and associated projects. I therefore call upon those charged with project implementation in government to avoid deficiencies in project designs, provide accurate initial estimates of the cost of projects, re-engineer the tendering and adjudication processes to ensure speedy delivery of projects, and to show adequate supervision of contractors to avoid cost overruns and unnecessary delays in project delivery. Most importantly, Madam Speaker, such projects should deliver on intended impact, anchored on sustainable inclusive growth and economic diversification. The private sector, Madam Speaker, plays a key role in the delivery of development programs, in particular through contractors who will be undertaking the various projects and activities planned for this financial year. Private contractors are critical in ensuring timely delivery of planned projects and the quality of final products. I therefore implore upon all contractors to demonstrate their social responsibility and ensure that projects are delivered on time, according to specifications, within budgets, and are of good quality. Furthermore, it is my hope that given the importance of the recently introduced economic stimulus program on economic growth and job creation, private contractors will cooperate with government in the delivery of the budget rather than stalling project implementation, resulting in cost overruns. Since most projects envisaged for 2016-17 and beyond are in the construction area which requires land, I would also appeal to the land authorities throughout the country to expedite the process of land allocation and servicing as part of their social responsibility in the delivery of our development programs and projects. Madam Speaker, let me take this opportunity to thank our bilateral and multilateral development partners, as I always do, as well as private foundations, for their contribution to our development agenda through their technical and financial support. Madam Speaker, I now move that the Appropriation 2016-17 Bill, number 1 of 2016, be read for the second time, and I thank you.